Thank you, Dr. Salil, for the nice overview of the imaging of the orbit. So after our keynote talk, we will move on to the next instruction course. That's on ocular oncology for the comprehensive ophthalmologist. Basically, the idea of this course is we should be aware of the atypical presentations of the various tumors of the ocular adnexa as well as the intraocular tumors. And this instruction course should help us in identifying those cases even if the presentation is atypical. So the speakers is going to basically focus on the clues which will help us in diagnosing those cases. So I would like to introduce my co-instructors, Dr. Anirban Bhaduri. He is from CMRI Kolkata. He is practicing ocular oncology and oculoplasty. He is our co-instructor here who is going to be talking on the intraocular tumors. We have Dr. Vikas Menon from Center for Sight, New Delhi, and he is going to be talk about the ocular surface tumors. I am Dr. Seema Das from Dr. Shroff Charity Eye Hospital, Delhi, and I'll be talking on the eyelid tumors and the orbital tumors. So I will start the course with the eyelid tumors. Basically, how do we know what are the warning signs of malignancy if we see an eyelid mass? So we know the eyelid tumors can arise from various structures, starting from the epidermis of the skin right till the conjunctival layer. There are adnexal structures in the eyelid, and the tumors can also arise from those structures. Many of them are benign, but there are some which can be malignant also. So if we see a patient like this, which looks quite kind of, you know, severe looking, pigmented lesion has caused lot of deformity in the eyelid, and if you look at the surface, it looks like there is some area of ulceration here, some irregularity, some kind of, you know, bleeding, some you know, thickening of the lid margin. So looking at it just on a cursory look, it actually looks like as if it's like malignant lesion. But this was actually a benign nevus, a split nevus or a kissing nevus as we commonly call it, and this patient has undergone multiple surgery, and this is the appearance following multiple surgery. So though these lesions look quite ominous, but this is a benign lesion. Vis-a-vis this lesion, which looks like a small eyelid nodule, can very well go as a lesion, but this is actually a sebaceous gland carcinoma. So sometimes the cursory look can be misleading, and we might mistake a malignancy as a benign lesion or a benign as a malignancy if we just go by the look of the lesion. If the lesions are something like this, then the diagnosis is quite obvious, but more often than not, we actually do not see the lesion at this stage. So it's important to suspect and detect the lesions early to prevent them from going into this stage. What about this? We all know what these lesions are. All of you, we see these lesions in our clinics. They are small cutaneous horns, as we call them, the skin tags, right? So what do we do for them? We just do a simple shave excision for these lesions, and I think and most of the time we do get a histopath done for these lesions. So this is squamous papillomas, also known as keratin horn, and a simple excision is the treatment of choice for those patients. So does this lesion, this patient, also look something similar like that? Similar, like we see a cutaneous horn also here. So is it a simple cutaneous horn or is it something more? What else do we see here? If you look at the base of this lesion, it has something at the base from where the horn seems to be arising. There seems to be a nodule here, which is slightly pigmented, not very well defined. There is some hyperemia at the edges from where the horn seem to be arising. So this was basically a squamous cell carcinoma on histopath with a cutaneous horn, and because of the collection of exuberant keratin, which is a feature of squamous cell carcinoma, this cutaneous horn has formed. So this horn was basically just the tip of the iceberg. This was not a benign lesion. The actual cause was an underlying malignancy. So a simple horn, if you just do a simple excision or a shave excision for a horn or for a lesion like this, we might miss out the malignancy, which is usually there at the base. So important in this lesion that we take it out in toto, especially the base, and instruct the pathologist that the base has to be looked in detail so that we can detect any malignancy if it is lying there. And if there is a squamous cell carcinoma, then this patient needs full thickness excision with margin clearance, like following the oncological principles of how do you manage an eyelid malignancy. So in a lesion like this, it's very important to look at the base. Again, another very common lesion which we see in the clinics day in and day out, elderly patients, these are seborrheic keratosis. Greasy, stuck-on kind of appearance, pigmented lesion, a very irregular surface, but these are benign lesions. They can be multiple also, as we see here. This patient has multiple lesions. A somewhat similar-looking lesion, pigmented lesion, seems like a stuck-on lesion, again very close to the lid margin, but does it look somewhat different than the previous lesion? Do you think this is also a similar lesion or it's some different? So it is different. The surface is not what we saw in the previous case. It's much more pigmented. It almost looks like, you know, pearly, irregular surface. And what is more important here is that at the center of the lesion, there seems to be some ulceration. And if you look at the edges of the lesion, it seems to be rolling inside at the edges of the ulcer. So this was not a simple seborrheic keratosis, a pigmented lesion. This was a basal cell carcinoma, a nodular variant of BCC, a pigmented BCC, which the whole extent of the lesion is somewhat similar to what it can appear on the surface. So looking at the surface of the lesion, specifically looking for any ulceration and irregularity are very, very important, because this could give us clue that we might be dealing with a malignant lesion rather than a benign one. So these are the various variants of basal cell carcinoma that we can see, the nodular variant and nodular ulcerative variant, where the diagnosis is quite apparent, but we can have cystic non-pigmented variant also like this. This is also basal cell carcinoma, not very common, and then we can have the sclerosing variant, also called as the morphiform variant, which might not present with a nodule, but it, like, the tumor spread superficially, and the exact extent of the lesion is much more than what is apparent on the surface. So these are the lesions which needs to be meticulously mapped. We might need frozen section control to map out the exact area of the lesion. Otherwise, if you leave behind this lesion, they can come back. So another patient who was referred with a diagnosis of a cicatricial ectropion, he gave a history of trauma a couple of months back, following which he noticed these changes in the eyelid. So he was diagnosed as having a cicatricial ectropion post-trauma, and he was sent for management of the same. Do you think it's a simple cicatricial ectropion or there is something more to it? So what additional finding he has is there is ulceration of the lid margin, which should not be there in a simple ectropion, which was attributed to the trauma probably. And then there are these areas of pigmentation here at the edges, and the edges, if you see carefully, seems to be a little rolled, hipped up. And the whole thing looks as if there is a lot of scarring. So this is again a variant, the sclerosing variant of basal cell carcinoma, which can cause a lot of sclerosis and fibrosis, can spread superficially and can cause slow destruction of the tissues around it. If you do not treat this lesion, ultimately they will go inside, invade the bone and cause much more extensive damage. So pigmentation at the edges, rolled in edges, ulceration, these are all features of malignancy, specifically a basal cell carcinoma. And in addition, this variant of BCC has a lot of cicatricial changes, probably because of which this was attributed to the post-trauma cicatrization. This patient we already saw, which presented like a small eyelid margin nodule, which was thought to be a lesion. But what is unusual here is that it is causing distortion of the lid margin. There is some distortion of the eyelashes. This is much more yellowish appearing than a normal lesion should be. So this was a very early squamous cell sebaceous gland carcinoma. And if you catch the patient at this stage, as full thickness excision with lid reconstruction will give both get rid of the disease and also give very good cosmetic results. So loss of eyelashes, lid margin thickening, recurrent lesion, if it comes back at the same site, we should suspect a sebaceous gland carcinoma. And if you're suspecting an SJC, but it might be still treating the patient like a lesion, that it's important that we send the material at least for histopathology to rule out if there is any atypical cells in that. If it comes out to be positive, then we need to go back, then treat it like a SJC, do a full thickness excision with margin clearance. So in our practice, almost about 20% of the cases of sebaceous gland carcinoma, the referral diagnosis was actually a lesion. That means that quite a few of them are misdiagnosed initially. And in just about 1/3 of the cases, the correct diagnosis of SJC was made before the patient was referred. Another variant of sebaceous gland carcinoma, this looks like, again, like a blepharitis, ulcerative blepharitis of the lid margin. But what is unusual was in this age group, we don't expect a ulcerative blepharitis, which is unilateral. Right? And in addition, we can see the small areas of yellowish nodule, which is there. There is this elevated area near the middle canthus. There is loss of eyelashes. The lid margin seems to be destroyed. So all these, again, point towards the variant of sebaceous gland carcinoma. And this SJC can, again, present like an ulcerative blepharitis. Another variant, a little more severe than the ulcerative blepharitis, is like a blepharoconjunctivitis, where there is involvement of the diffuse involvement of the conjunctiva also, which we have seen in the previous IC also. So the point here, the clues here are this yellowish appearance, diffuse thickening of the lid margin, loss of eyelashes, and this diffuse hyperemia of the conjunctiva. So this is a pagitoid variant of sebaceous gland carcinoma, which can present like a diffuse blepharoconjunctivitis. And any persistent unilateral blepharoconjunctivitis which is not responding to your conventional treatment, we must suspect a pagitoid SGC and then try to find the diagnosis. And we need to biopsy these patients to get the diagnosis. Now, if you have to biopsy this lesion, do we biopsy it by a technique which is known as MAP biopsy? Means that there is no specified nodule where from where you can take your biopsy. So you biopsy the whole ocular surface, whole area which seems to be involved. So there are multiple sites from where small bits of conjunctiva are taken. Those are marked on a filter paper. Like if you take this from the limbal area, medial and lateral limbus, you mark it. The same diagram is made on your OR sheet so that you can correlate with the histopath findings and you know which area is coming out to be positive. So then each piece is then picked up by the pathologist, they are processed separately, and then they can give you a report like, you know, this number one, number two, number three, or number four are positive, and based on that you can plan your treatment. Another gentleman, again an elderly one, who was referred with a diagnosis of an ectropion, right eye lower lid ectropion. Okay, so does it look like a simple ectropion or there's something a little more to it? There is loss of eyelashes, absolutely. There is thickening of the conjunctiva and there is a lot of hyperemia of the whole conjunctiva, whole ocular surface in fact, which should not be there in a simple, like, you know, involutional ectropion, what we see in this age group. So this was again a pagitoid sebaceous gland carcinoma causing diffuse hyperemia or diffuse inflammation of the ocular surface. And after the first surgery and the topical treatment, the patient was not keen for any, salvaging the eye. This is what he landed up with. After a year or so, he came back with a massive recurrence, and we can see this area of papillary appearance of the conjunctiva here, thickening here, and now the diagnosis is much more apparent. And ultimately, the patient had to land up with exudation. This looks absolutely normal, or does it look anything abnormal in this patient? Is there anything abnormal or looks absolutely fine? Yeah, there is a slight thickening of the eyelid of the left eye, maybe causing a very mild ptosis, not very apparent here, but if we evert the eyelid, we have the diagnosis. Okay, and again, sebaceous gland carcinoma, like which can present like, and you know what, again, this patient also, as she's a younger patient, slight thickening of the eyelid. She came actually with a diagnosis of ptosis for the ptosis correction. But then if we evert the eyelid, we know what it is. It's a mechanical ptosis caused by the tumor. So another variant of sebaceous gland carcinoma, which can present almost like a placoid thickening, what we see in squamous cell carcinoma. So it's important in any acquired ptosis, if you are finding any thickening of the eyelid, it's look at the, evert the lid, and sometimes the things can be lurking in the fornix. So double eversion might be needed at times if you don't find anything on the single eversion. Normal morphological variants of sebaceous gland carcinoma, which we can see, we can get the ulcerative variant, nodular, which we see, and these are the ones which most commonly mimic calesion. We can have a diffuse eyelid thickening, which are the one which mimics blepharoconjunctivitis, and if, you know, things are massive like this, then the diagnosis is very apparent. So, and SGC can present something which is very small and innocuous, which can look like a lid margin nodule, like a calesion, or can be a placoid thickening, and not all the typical morphological variants are always apparent in patients. Moving on to the next patient, this was again a young girl. She was being treated for allergic conjunctivitis. She used to get this persistent redness, irritation and occasional redness of the eyes on and off, and she was diagnosed as allergic conjunctivitis and was getting the treatment for the same for some time. And when you look at the conjunctiva, this is what we see. And this is a high magnification photograph. Does it look like the conjunctiva of an allergic conjunctivitis? Is there any papillae, follicle? Does it look like a follicular conjunctivitis, papillary conjunctivitis? So there is somewhat like, you know, cobblestone sort of appearance of the conjunctiva, or probably that is the reason it was thought of like an allergic etiology. But what we see here is a localized area of increased vascularity, blood vessels. She in fact had a resolving hemorrhage in this area. So what this patient had was conjunctival amyloidosis. Okay, and allergic conjunctivitis won't have this waxy, white appearing conjunctiva, it would be hyperemic. So amyloidosis typically presents like a waxy, very white, yellowish white appearing area, and the typical features are recurrent hemorrhages which happens at the same site. So if in a patient, if you find this sort of appearance and a diagnosis of recurrent hemorrhage, and amyloidosis should be suspected, and again we can confirm the diagnosis by doing a biopsy. Some more appearance of conjunctival amyloidosis. And this color, what we see in the second patient, is quite characteristic, a yellowish, whitish, very waxy appearing surface. So why it's important to detect amyloidosis? Because it can have systemic implication beyond the eyes. It can be part of systemic amyloidosis, can be part of multiple myeloma, and this patient needs to be worked up to rule out in multiple myeloma at least. Saying all these things, it's not that everything which looks abnormal in the eyelid is tumor. Sometimes there are other things. It's like a reverse masquerade, the infective pathology or the inflammatory pathology, which can actually look like tumor. This patient looked like sebaceous gland carcinoma. We thought it was an SGC. There is diffuse thickening of the eyelid, little yellowish appearance, some loss of eyelashes, and on biopsy it turned out to be a conjunctival tuberculosis. Another patient looks like, you know, placoid appearance, which we saw in the sebaceous gland carcinoma patient, came with a ptosis, patchy areas of whitish placoid lesions. Again, on biopsy, turned out to be a conjunctival tuberculosis. And if you see here, this gentleman had a diffuse erythema of the both the upper and the lower lid, which is, in fact, extending beyond the eyelid near the brow area also, was referred with a diagnosis of an hemangioma, like a capillary hemangioma or Sturge-Weber syndrome, what we see. But ultimately, when you worked up this patient, he had features of, you know, loss of sensation. He has those hypopigmented patches and turned out to be an Hansen's disease. So not everything which looks like malignant or abnormal are malignant. Sometimes you can have infective pathology which can, you know, masquerade a malignancy. So to conclude, any documented growth in an eyelid lesion is suspicious. Any abnormal surface, ulceration of the surface, any distortion of the lid margin, loss of eyelashes, hemorrhages, all these are the features which will give us a clue that we could be dealing with something which is more ominous. And if the patient is not responding to the treatment which you have given, then these are the indications that we should suspect a malignancy and go ahead with a biopsy and treat the patient accordingly. Thank you.